Hello, welcome to another of Huddersfield Local History Society's 2020-2021 season of online talks. Today's speaker, Peter Burton, is a member of the Society and a member of the Yorkshire Archaeological Society and the Yorkshire Vernacular History Study Group. For many people, the study of our part of the world is really about the last 200 years. It begins and ends there because, after all, that's where the evidence seems to be. It's richest, it's most thickly on the ground. But as W.D.G. Hoskins, the landscape historian, famously said, everything is so much older than you think. And it's the history of the landscape of this part of the world to which Peter has devoted so much of his energy and research time over a number of years now. But it's not the landscape of the Industrial Revolution that concerns him, nor the landscape of mills and the textile industry and the communities that grew up around them. It's a much earlier landscape, nevertheless vital landscape, a much earlier landscape, the evidence of which is still there. It's the landscape of the medieval Pennines, and in particular, the medieval Holme Valley. Peter.
Thank you, Cyril, for that introduction, and hello everyone. Thanks very much for tuning in. We're going to be talking about the medieval Holme Valley over the next 40 minutes or so. I hope you find the talk interesting. Many people will be familiar with the landscape around Holmfirth in West Yorkshire, with its enclosed fields, dry stone walls, and weavers' cottages. This is a landscape founded largely in the 17 and 1800s. However, hidden within this landscape are clues to an earlier history, that of the Middle Ages. It is this period, from the 1200s to the 1500s, that form the subject of this talk. So how do we know anything at all about this period? Well, much of the Holme Valley was known as the Graveship of Holme, and was part of that great medieval estate known as the Manor of Wakefield. This map shows the extent of the manor, split into two main parts, with Halifax, the centre of the northern part, and Wakefield, the south. The Graveship of Holme, one of 13 graveships directly managed for the Lord himself, is in the lowest southwest section. The manor held a court every 3 weeks, where the land transactions, misdemeanours and other matters relating to the manor were heard. Most of these cases resulted in a payment or a fine of some kind, the money of which went directly to the lord of the manor, and these courts were a great source of income for him. Proceedings of these courts were written down as a permanent record, known today as the court rolls. As the photo on the right shows, they were literally rolled up for storage. Although written in Latin, many of these rolls have been transcribed into English and published. These court transcripts provide an amazing amount of detail about life in the Manor of Wakefield and the Graveship of Holme, and they form the largest single source of information that we have from the area. But there are other sources of information as well, including maps. This is the earliest map that we have of the Graveship of Holme. It was drawn in the mid-1700s, but according to the inscription at the bottom, it was a copy of one from a period of King Henry V, who died in 1422. The map shows hamlets and small settlements whose names can still be found in the area today. The boundary of the graveship is described, and using natural features such as watercourses, large boulders and other landmarks is clearly defined in the inscription at the bottom. Note too the orientation of the map, with what is actually north facing down. This lends some support to it being of medieval origin, as by the mid-18th century, when this copy was made, maps were being drawn with the north at the top, same way as we have them today. You might also be able to read the words Holme Moss in the top right-hand corner, which is in fact in the southwest of the graveship. This detail from the map is probably what the chapel at Holmfirth looked like in the 1700s when the map was drawn. In the 1400s, when the original map was created, Holmfirth as a town did not exist. It was just a chapel and a corn mill. The words Bridge Mill can just be made out at the bottom of the slide. Other evidence for life in the Holme Valley is contained within the general landscape, and this is a theme which we will look at shortly. But what did people who lived here do? Today, most of us associate the Holme Valley with the old industries of weaving and sheep farming, known as the jewel economy. But this was not the case in the Middle Ages. This slide shows a list of some of the occupations from the graveship of Holme during the medieval period. The dates show when a person is first recorded in the manor court rolls, alongside their trades. Many of these are trades which would be expected in a medieval community such as this, things like tailor, shepherd, butcher, etc. But there are some unfamiliar trades in this list as well. Austin Pelliperius, toward the bottom, was a preparer of animal skins. Nicholas the Petrichor was a collector of partridges, and John the Hewer was a stone quarryman. There was no industry as we would know it at the time, and many of these occupations may only have had a single person in the role. The graveship was predominantly a farming area, and most tenants would have worked land for their living. This is the miller depicted in the fantastic Luttrell Psalter of the 1340s. This manuscript detail shows a windmill, but this was not the type used in the graveship of Holme, where water-powered mills were used. The image shows the miller as an unsavoury character, and this is typical of the period when millers were often portrayed like this, such as grasping and were generally unpopular. There are several cases of millers being taken to court for dishonesty in the graveship, and we will hear about one of these later in the talk. This detail shows the type of mill the tenants of the Holme Valley would be more familiar with, a water mill, of course. The original and the only medieval mill for a time was known as the Cartworth Mill, and it was located, probably, along the river to where the post office is in the centre of Holmfirth, although we don't know for certain the exact location of the medieval water mills. Later, in the 1300s, a second corn mill was built, a mile or two downstream from the Cartworth Mill, at a place still known today as New Mill. Notice in the image the timber-framed corn mill building with its thatched roof and wickerwork fish traps in the mill pond. Floods, then as now, were a constant problem. There is an entry in the court rolls for October 1313 when it was noted that Cartworth Mill was carried away by the overflowing of the river, together with the house and the dam. These mills were operated by a consortium of businessmen, one of whom was the miller himself, and they paid a fee to farm the mill. This took the form of an annual rent paid to the manor by the miller and his associates. In return, all of the tenants of the graveship were impelled to have their grain processed in the manorial mill, with fines imposed for not doing so. The miller took a percentage of the flour for himself in payment, which he could then sell. This slide shows the fluctuating rentals payable for farming the Holme Valley corn mills. First of all for Cartworth Mill alone, and then, after 1315, for both mills. Note how the rental values fluctuate. The dip in 1305, from £14 a year to just £5 a year, is probably one of those years when the mill was out of action due to flood damage. See how the rent nearly doubles when the second mill comes online in 1315. But also notice from 1350 onwards, the rental crashes to a third of its former value. The plague, or Black Death, came to the Holme Valley between 1348 and 1350, decimating the population. And this is evidenced in the fall of rental income. But also note that the period just leading up to the plague was also one of economic decline, which was made worse by the plague outbreak. It was farming that formed the main economy of the medieval Holme Valley. We'll now take a look at medieval farming in the valley and the evidence for it still to be found in the landscape today. The scattered settlements where people lived were usually placed high up on the valley sides. This is a view from the medieval settlement of Dunsley in Carworth, looking towards the hamlet of Cliff. The medieval fields where people grew their crops are on the level ground in the middle distance, and this type of location is typical for the area. These fields are still known as Wooldale West Fields, and were some of the open fields farmed by medieval inhabitants of that village. If we take a look at the 1854 Ordnance Survey map, we can see the West Field to the southwest of Wooldale. The boundary of the open field was still pretty well defined at this time, but the interior, once unenclosed strips of land, have been subdivided into individual fields using dry stone walls. This would have happened sometime after the Middle Ages, probably in the 1700s. The lane running through the centre is probably the medieval access track to the open fields. Local farmers needed the cooperation of their neighbours in the open fields throughout the year. It was necessary for crops to be planted and harvested at the same time, not only to prevent damage to neighbouring crops, but also to share plough teams and labour. Not all of the fields in the Graveship of Holme were communal, however, and there were many enclosed fields, known at the time as closes. These closes were used solely by the tenant who paid an annual rent for them. They were used for pasture or for growing fodder and hay. Sometimes the tenant built a house in one of his closes. Most of the settlements in the Holme Valley, even the smallest ones, seem to have had one or more town fields associated with them. They were divided, as we have heard, into long strips and allocated to the farmers who paid a rent for the amount of land they used. Sometimes, like this example belonging to the medieval hamlet of Hogley, evidence for the former strips can still be found fossilised in later enclosures. Upper Thong, being one of the larger medieval settlements, had two town fields, one to the west of the village and one to the east. This old township map of Upper Thong, dated 1802, shows the east field, subdivided with stone walls by this time. The boundary of the town fields is defined by the still existing lane to the south and by the line of the edge of the fields to the north. If we look closer, we can see the remains of one of the medieval strips still surviving, with its characteristic soft curved S shape and called simply field. These are Upper Thong West Fields, partly on sloping ground as you can see, and partly further to the left on more level ground. The medieval open strips have been preserved by long stone walls following the same lines. Ridge and furrow was a medieval farming technique designed for these open fields. The ridge was where the crops were grown, and the furrow was to drain away excess water. This technique was used in the Holme Valley, and although they have mostly been ploughed flat over the intervening centuries, sometimes the former ridge and furrows can still be detected. Examples of faint ridge and furrow can be seen near Fulston Hall, as shown in the top photo, and also in Austenly Town Fields, shown in the bottom photo. On more steeply sloping fields, of which there were many in the Holme Valley, the natural gradient was sufficient to provide drainage, and so ridge and furrow was not always used. This photo, taken near Fulston Hall, shows the fields with boundary hedges rather than dry stone walls that now form such a landscape feature in the Holme Valley. In the Middle Ages, many closes were bounded by hedges such as these, and this view, with its wooded hedges, is probably more representative of the medieval landscape. We'll now take a brief look at how people lived, their houses, their leisure time, and the community they lived in. The tenants of the Graveship of Holme, and this continued until quite recent times, lived in townships, or vills as they were often called. They probably had little concept of the Graveship as a place. It was an administrative area to which they paid rents and taxes. There were 7 townships in the Graveship of Holme, as shown on this map, each one colour-coded. The division of land within these townships was actually much more complicated than it appears here, as there were small parcels of land belonging to one township within the boundaries of another. Also note how some parts of a township, especially Austenly, Cartworth, are separated into detached portions. The reasons for these complicated land divisions, which also occur in other graveships in the manor of Wakefield, isn't fully understood. As an administrative area, the Graveship of Holme had clear boundaries separating it from adjoining manors, although these boundaries could be rather less clear across open moorland, and there were many boundary disputes. This photo shows the eroded remnants of a probable double bank and ditch forming the boundary of the Graveship. To the right is the Graveship of Holme, and to the left is the manor of Meltham, which lay in the honour of Pontefract, another great medieval Yorkshire estate. This slide shows a selection of places in the Graveship that were in existence by at least 1315. We can see that the medieval name and the modern name hasn't changed that much, apart from the spelling. Alongside the name is the altitude that they were located at, and you will notice that they are all between 200 and 300 metres. This band seems to have been the optimal location for these medieval Pennine communities, as the same range can be found in other similar areas, such as around Hebden Bridge. And I want to share with you some original research about the farmers in the Graveship of Holme and who owned the land before we move on. Land tenure, as it was known, had rules of ownership that were particular to the manor of Wakefield, and these were always referred to in the records as being the custom of the manor. The rent payable per acre varied over time, and the conditions of tenancy were also revised during the medieval period. There are no detailed records of land ownership from the Middle Ages surviving, but this survey, a page of which is shown here on the screen, dates to the reign of Queen Elizabeth I. It is a very useful document to give us an idea of the distribution of land in the decades just after the medieval period, and we can draw some parallels backwards into the Middle Ages. The document is written in English and records all the land occupiers and the rents payable in the Graveship of Holme. It lists the name of all the landholders, how many acres of land they held, and where in the Graveship it was. It also tells us how much rent they paid per acre, and if the land was occupied as freehold, copyhold, or leasehold. The document itself isn't dated, but we can make an estimate of its date by the frequent reference in the document to grants of land by Mr. Tusser. William Tusser, Esquire, was the clerk to the Duchy of Lancaster between 1572 and 1587, and to which the manor of Wakefield belonged at the time. We can be confident, therefore, that this survey dates to that short period. Copyhold tenure was the normal landholding in the graveship of Holme in the Middle Ages. This means that the land was still owned by the lord of the manor, but the holder could sell the use of the land to somebody else, he could raise a mortgage on it, and he could bequeath it to his heirs in his will, as long as an annual rent per acre is paid to the lord, and also that a fee was paid for every transfer. A small number of farmers owned a few acres of their land freehold. In other words, they owned the land outright, which they had bought from or had been granted by the manor. A few tenants only leased their land from the manor, but leasehold land had the lowest security of tenure, and it could be seen as temporary and was not a common method here. Most landholders held multiple parcels of land in the graveship, often in different townships, and many of them held land both freehold and copyhold. This graph shows the detail of the survey, which I hope I haven't made too complicated. The total number of acres being rented in the graveship was 3,015 at this time. There were 146 different landholders who were mainly men, but some of them were women as well, and all of the landholders were classified as tenants. Many of them were related to each other, such as fathers and sons, brothers, uncles, etc. So the number of different families farming the land was much lower than this. The bars on the graph show the number of acres of farmland per township, and the coloured divisions show the type of land. The green divisions show the copyhold land, and this clearly was the majority. There are some other interesting points to note. For example, notice that the township of Hepworth has the largest percentage of freehold land, and Wooldale, next door, has the lowest. The reasons for these differences are not completely clear without further research, but they are interesting. The differences between the amounts of farmed land per township are much easier to understand. At a glance, you can see which townships held the best agricultural land and which held more wasteland or moorland within their boundaries. This distribution of good agricultural land probably still holds true today. I must stress also that this data is from the 16th century and so not entirely transferable to the Middle Ages. We can gauge from the land transfer records in the manor court rolls, for example, that freehold land was much less common during the Middle Ages, even than this. To continue on more general themes, there were no stone buildings in the graveship of Holme in the Middle Ages, or at least we haven't found any evidence for any. Unlike the house shown in this image, so apologies for any confused messages there, but I do like the atmosphere of this picture. No, buildings here were made of wood with timber frames and were the only type of structures locally. Unless they travelled to towns such as Wakefield, tenants of the graveship would only encounter a large stone building when they went to the parish church, such as this one at Kirkburton. Kirkburton was the parish church for the townships on the south side of the River Holme, such as Fulston and Hepworth, etc. Those on the north, that is Holme, Austerley and Upper Thong, were in Ormondby parish. There was a chapel of ease in Holmfirth from the mid-1300s, but this could not perform baptisms, marriages or funerals, and it was also very small and made of wood. The church at Kirkburton was also used for large gatherings of graveship tenants, where laws and other important announcements would be read out aloud. Attendance at such gatherings was mandatory, and failure to attend incurred a fine, although most of these were held on a Sunday, when the majority of tenants would be at church anyway. We don't have any timber houses remaining from the Middle Ages either, but many later stone houses are built upon the earlier footprint. An example is here at Booth House in the Upper Valley. This photo shows Booth House with its two-storey weaver's cottages of the late 17 and early 1800s. We can get a glimpse of how Booth House looked before the Industrial Revolution and how it probably looked in medieval times from this map. It is of Booth House and surrounding land and was drawn in 1745 to show the estate belonging to a John Ardington. This detail from the map shows all the houses at Booth House as single-storey cottages. They are probably still timber-framed at this time in 1745, and many of the stone houses built there today are in the same position as these timber cottages, and so very likely built upon their medieval predecessors. Sometimes old house timbers have survived, and these have been often reused within later buildings. Oak beams were expensive and lasted a very long time, so this isn't very surprising. Many reused timbers in this area are often from what are known as crook frames. These were curved timbers used to form an A-frame and, when used in series, could form the structure of a house. This type of framing was common in the Holme Valley. This old photograph on the slide is a barn at Wooldale Hall, exposing a crook frame during demolition. These crooks may originally have been used from a house. This slide shows a post-medieval barn made with crook frames. The barn is much taller and larger than a medieval house, but the building technique is very much the same. The estimated population of the graveship in 1379 was 300 to 400 people. This figure is based on the only document concerning numbers that we have, the poll tax returns from that year. This was a period only one generation after the Black Death, which, as we have heard, came to the Holme Valley between 1348 and 1350. The population of Yorkshire as a whole was reduced massively by the plague, and so settlements in the Holme Valley in 1379 were still recovering from that devastation. We know from the court rolls of the 1360s, for example, only 10 years or so after the plague, that much agricultural land in the graveship was unused for, as we are told, want of a tenant. Also, we can see in the records new names appear, such as Robert of Lupset, a village near Wakefield, and William of Craven, which is around Skipton, possibly attracted to the area by low rents and the availability of land following the plague. By the 1430s, signs of recovery are revealed in the records by a large increase in new agricultural land taken from the moors and further new family names appearing in the records for the very first time. Land such as this on the slide, formerly moorland or waste at Bradshaw above Digley Reservoir, was first settled during this period and is an indication of a new demand for land, even in such marginal locations as this. We will now take a look at a few actual cases taken from the medieval manor court rolls involving people from the graveship of Holme. Each township elected someone from their community as the grave, who served for 1 year. One of the many roles of a grave was collecting the rents from tenants and taking the money to the manor offices in Wakefield. This interesting case in the court rolls records the former grave, Richard Brown, being robbed of the collected rents amounting to 10 marks, which was £6, 13 shillings, a fortune in 1277. It is not clear if he was genuinely robbed on Embley Moor or if he pocketed the money himself. In either case, he was forced to pay it all back to the manor in instalments over 3 years. If it was a genuine theft, it would have been very difficult for an ordinary tenant like this to raise such a large sum of money, and we don't know if or how we managed to do it. To give the amount of money some value, a soldier's yearly wage at this time was about £2. During the reign of King Edward I, it was required that each township in England provided one man from the community to join the King's army for the Scottish Wars. The Lord of the Manor of Wakefield at this time, the Earl Warren, was a renowned captain in the King's army against the Welsh in the late 1200s and also against the Scots. Enlisting the Earl's tenants into the army and taking them to war was an expected part of life at that time. However, as this case brought to the Wakefield court in 1296 shows, desertion was frequent. We see that several men from the Graveship of Holme, such as Richard of Booth House, William of Austenly, Richard of Cartworth, and others, were all heavily fined for desertion. A later case from the Graveship of Holme, this time from a court held in October 1316, concerns a local man called Thomas Bagshaw. The court rolls tell us that he absconded from the King's army in Scotland. He was fined 20 shillings or a pound, equivalent to about half a year's wages. He was then returned to the army and sent back to Scotland. And just as an aside, the photo used here is of a knight of about the same period as Thomas Bagshaw, but as Thomas would have been a lowly foot soldier, he would certainly not have been equipped with this fine armour shown in the effigy here. Thomas, if he was lucky, would have had a leather jacket. We heard earlier of millers who ran the corn mills in the Graveship of Holme, sometimes being taken to court by the tenants. In some cases, the miller was found guilty. In others, he was falsely accused. In this case, brought to court in 1266, we hear that the miller of Cartworth Mill, a Richard Stirk, was accused of using a false measure for a period of 11 weeks, thereby giving the tenants less flour than they were due. A subsequent inquiry ordered by the court found the measure used by the miller to be good, and the accuser, a Graveship tenant called Adam Cousin, was himself fined 1 mark, which was 13 shillings and fourpence, for making a false claim. This, in fact, was a common charge against millers, and other court cases have shown that some of the accusations were justified. Millers were known to fiddle the scales and give short measures, but probably not as commonly as people believed. Between the years 1315 and 1317, there was a national famine caused by a succession of crop failures due to bad weather. There is lots of evidence for the effects of the famine in the Holme Valley, with many records of land being left unused at this time, a higher than normal number of land transfers due to the death of the current occupier, and also falling rents. This final case, brought to the court, tells a personal story and impact. Agnes, the daughter of Robert of Austenly, had stolen 13 oat cakes from her neighbour, Adam of Hogley. This picture is taken from Cartworth Moor looking towards Hogley. Austenly is on the left of the picture and Hogley is on the right. The two families in this case must have known one another, as the distance between them is only about half a mile. 13 oat cakes was the object of the burglary by Agnes during a famine, and we can only guess at the circumstances that led her to this act. Well, that is the end of my talk. If you'd like to know a little bit more about the medieval Holme Valley, I have written a book shown here. Please drop me an email on the address shown at the bottom of the screen for more details. Thank you.
This talk has been one of Huddersfield Local History Society's 2020-2021 programme. We are a membership society and it would be very good if you could come and join us. But if you can't do that, given these difficult COVID times, you can visit our website. There you'll be able to find out what we do, who we are, and what sort of events and publications we have. Thank you for coming and listening to the talk. We hope to see you again next time. Goodbye for now.